last video, we created a column array of transistor wrappers. The ports of each of these wrappers were connected to each other with metal layers. In this video, we'll connect two of these arrays and back vias to make a cell, and then make an array of cells to complete our design. Here is a schematic of the power cell. We note that the cell contains two copies of the column array connected by each respective port, and a third port is connected to ground through back vias. Let's get to work on the layout for this design. Let's place the back via on the origin. We can move and mirror this back via more precisely using the layout command line. Use the F1 hotkey to open up the command line. We can move the back via up by selecting the back via, entering the command DY50, and pressing apply. If we want to copy and mirror the back via over the x-axis, we use FX0. In the schematic, we saw the emitter ports of the column array were connected to the back vias. Let's place a column array such that it can be easily and efficiently connected to the back vias. In advance, I've determined that the column array should be placed at the coordinates -88, -122.5. We'll use coordinate entry to place it accurately. We'll make a mirrored copy of the column array as we saw in the schematic. Press F1 to open up the command line. Select the array and type an FY0 command. At any time, you can see the other commands that you can apply from the command line by selecting the Help button. We need to make metal connections between the collectors and the emitters, as we saw on the schematic. Remember that the collectors are in the metal 2 layer and the emitters are metal 1. In this case, it's easier to start on the top left corner with vertex snap and use coordinate entry to make a size that you want. For my connection, I made a 4x3 metal rectangle. You can utilize the hotkey C, which is copy using reference, to make a copy and place it using the vertex snap. Your first click is the vertex you will use to reference for placement. I'll click on the bottom right corner so I can snap it to the bottom right of the destination. I'll now add all the other connections on the layers that are necessary. If you calculate the dimensions you need in advance, using coordinate entry with vertex snap and copy using reference can greatly expedite the drawing precision and efficiency. After we complete the design, we should run DRC and LVS as we did in previous steps. For the sake of conserving time in this video, I won't show the output of these verification steps. I've gone ahead and created an array of the power cell devices. As we did with the column array, we can use the array copy and paste to make correctly spaced copies. When the metal layers are larger, our design rules recommend that we leave metal layers at least 4 microns from each other. I've also connected the ports of the individual power cells together. As before, we've placed rectangles on the correct layers to build the connections. In previous steps, we omitted the pins from our design, but this time we will need to place the pins for when we eventually place the pads. We'll see this more clearly in the next step of this design. Here you can see in the schematic that we have 3 pins, one for the collector output, one for the capacitor input, and one for the ballast resistors. We'll now place pins on their respective layers and save our design. Here's the final schematic for the power cell array. Note here that our entire array has been represented with 1 amp symbol. From pin 1, we have pads 2 through 6, and we have pad 1 for pin 2 and pad 7 for pin 3. Let's start with pin 1. Note that as we drag pad 2, it shows us that we need to be connected to pin 1 with the flight line. As we drop more pads, it shows us the connections that we need to make between pads and pins. We'll continue the process of dropping pads and add metal connects as necessary. After all the pads are connected, we now have a finished product. This can be used as one of the components in a larger power amplifier module. I'll take some time to briefly recap what exactly we covered over the last three videos on RFIC design and help review why we took the time to do what we did. First, remember that a connection on the schematic can look different than a connection on the layout. A metal rectangle on the same layer that connects two components on layout translates to a connection on the schematic. LVS will check to make sure that your nodes are connected correctly on layout. There are two ways to draw rectangles precisely. If you have vertex snap enabled, a quick way to enter your rectangles is to snap to the first vertex and use coordinate entry to insert the diagonal point of the rectangle using a relative coordinate. You can also draw an approximate rectangle shape and play with the values on the Properties tab to fit the rectangle to the location and shape that you want. We want to avoid a couple of things in our design. One, we want to make sure that we don't unintentionally move around our shapes on our layers. In part 1 of the RFIC videos, we turned off the move handles and drag and drop move. We also want to make sure that there are no acute angles. This is checked with the DRC tool. Although most of our connections were rectangles in the RFIC design, preventing acute angles will be of greater importance in future videos. Finally, we want to make sure that we run DRC and LVS after our design steps. This will prevent future headaches as you move up the hierarchy of design, and so your design can function as you expect. This concludes the RFIC power cell design in the layout overview series. Thank you for watching this Keysight ESOF EDA tutorial. You can find a link to a free trial of ADS in the video description below.